This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book, No Mont's Island. Author, Herbert Strang. Chapter 1, No Man's Island. One hot August afternoon, a motorboat with a little dinghy in tow was thrashing its way up a narrow, winding river in southern Wessex. The stream, swollen by the drainage of overnight rain from the high moors that loomed in the hazy blue distance, was running riotously, casting buffets of spray across the bows of the little craft, and tossing like a cork the dinghy astern. On either side, a dense entanglement of shrubs, bushes, and saplings overhung the water's edge, forming a sort of rampart or outwork for the taller trees behind. The occupants of the boat were three. Amidships, its owner, Phil Warrender, was dividing his attention between the engine and the tiller. Warrender was tall, lithe, swarthy, with crisp black hair which seemed to lift his cap as an irksome incubus. A little abaft of him sat Jack Armstrong, bent forward over an ordnance map. He had the lean, tight-skinned features, spare frame, and hard muscles of the athlete, and his hay-colored hair was cropped as close as a prize fighter's. In the bows on the scrap of deck, Percy Pratt, facing the others, squatted cross-legged like an oriental cobbler and dreamily twanged a banjo. He was shorter and of stouter build than his companions, with a round, chubby face and brown curly hair clustering close to his poll, and caressing the edge of his cap like the tendrils of a creeper. All three boys were in their 18th year, and wore the flannels, caps, and blazers of their school 11. "We ought to be nearing this island," remarked Armstrong, looking up from his map. "I say, Pratt, you've been here before. Can't you remember something about it?" Pratt thrummed his strings, smiled sweetly, and sang in the head notes of a light tenor. "The roses have made me remember all that I tried to forget. The past with its pain comes back again, filling my heart with... Sorry, old man, I've pitched it a bit too high. Lend me your ears while I modulate from G to E flat. Keep your Percy's reliques for serenading the moon. You were here as a kid, aren't we nearly there? The past with its pawn fact. It was pain. My old uncle could beat any beak at licking. He made a very pretty criss-cross pattern on me that day, all for pinching a peach. Frightful temper he had. My people said it was due to sunstroke on his travels. Jolly lot of good being a famous traveler, if it makes you a beast. He was more ratty every time he came home. I don't wonder my pater had a royal row with him, and hasn't been near the place since. Rough luck, to have to desert your ancestral dust heap. I try to forget you, but I only love you more. Isn't that the island? Away there to starboard?" Warrender interposed. "But I thought you said we might camp there, my Percy?" "True, sober Philip. We picnicked there in the days of yore. Well, we'd have to do a week's clearing before we camp there now. Look at it." Pratt swung lazily round on his elbow and gazed over the starboard quarter towards the left bank. The river was parted by what was evidently an island. The channel between it and the left bank was very narrow and almost impassable by reason of the low overhanging branches which formed a tunnel of foliage. Warrender steered across the broader channel towards the right bank, all three scanning the island intently as they coasted along. "Shows how old tempus fugit," said Pratt. "In the dim and distant ages when I was a kid that island was a lawn. Now it's a wilderness. Think what your beardless cheeks will be like in 10 years' time, Armstrong. See what nature will do, unless you use the razor. The place seems quite changed somehow. But I'd never have believed trees could grow so fast. As we're not dicky birds, we certainly can't pitch our camp there. Drive on, old shover." The island was, indeed, to all appearances, more densely wooded than the riverbanks. By the map scale, it was about a third of a mile long, and at its widest part fully half as broad. Nowhere along its whole extent did they see a spot suitable for camping. They ran past the island. The stream narrowed, the wooded character of the mainland banks was unchanged. "We might as well be on the Congo," growled Armstrong. "Are you sure your uncle didn't bring back a bit of Africa in his carpet bag, Pratt, and plank it down here? Let the great big world keep turning, never mind if I've got you. hummed Pratt. Turn your eyes 3 points a starboard, Armstrong, and you'll see, peeping at you through the sylvan groves, the gables of my ancestors' eligible and beautifully situated riverside residence. It's pretty nearly a quarter mile from the river, but that's a detail. Warrender slowed down, so that they might get a better view of the stately old house of which they caught glimpses through gaps in the woodland. You behold that ruined ivy-clad tower about a cable's length away from it, Pratt went on. Tradition saith that one of my ancestors, incarcerated there a foeman unworthy of his steel, and forgot to feed him. Well, I want my tea, said Armstrong. We had next to no lunch, and I can't live on memories. A sharp crack cut the air. Someone's shooting in the woods ahead, said Warrender. Perhaps we'll catch sight of them and get a direction. Why not make a polite inquiry of that woodland fawn or satyr smoking a clay pipe yonder? Suggested Pratt, pointing with his banjo to the left bank. On a tree stump near the water's edge sat a thick-set man, square-faced, beetle-browed, blear-eyed, a cloth cap pushed back on his close-cropped bullet head, a red cloth tie knotted about his neck. He wore a rusty, much-rubbed velveteen jacket, corduroy breeches, and a pair of shabby leggings. Warrender slowed down until the boat just held its own against the current and called, "Hi, can you tell us of a clear space where we can camp?" The man looked suspiciously from one to another, chewing the stem of his pipe. "Can't," said he surlily. "Surely there's a stretch of turf somewhere." Warrender persisted. "Faint? Not hereabouts. Woods, from here to village up along. Nothing back on the island?" The man half closed his eyes, and again suspicion lurked in the glance he gave the speaker. "No. No man's island be naught but furze and thicket. Nothing hereabouts. Better go on and doss at the ferry inn." Then, however, he leered, barely recovering his pipe as it slipped from between his discolored teeth. I were forgetting," he said with a chuckle. "There be a patch farther up. Aye, that might suit ee. A party camped there last week. I try n." He chuckled again. Warrender opened the throttle, and when the boat had run a few yards up, a guffaw, quickly stifled, sounded astern. "Pleasant fellow," remarked Armstrong. "When you are near, the dullest day seems bright, doubts disappear, my load of care grows light." Warbled Pratt. But he didn't say which bank it's on. "We can't miss it," said Warrender, "unless he was pulling our leg." Within 3 minutes, however, they found that the man had not misled them. There was disclosed on the right bank a considerable stretch of smooth green sward, affording ample space for their bell tent and the simple impedimenta of their camp. Warrender ran the boat in and hitched it to a sapling, then the three began to transfer their equipment to the shore. Besides their tent, they had a primus stove, a kettle, a couple of saucepans, pots, cups, and plates of enamel, pewter forks and stainless knives, cases of provisions, 3 sleeping bags, 3 folding stools, and other oddments. While Warrender and Armstrong were stretching and pegging out the tent, Pratt started the stove, filled the kettle from the river, and assembled such utensils as they needed for their tea. These operations were punctuated by renewed sounds of shooting, which were drawing nearer through the woods that skirted the clearing. "I say, you chaps," cried Pratt, "I wonder if I talked nicely, if I could coax out of them something gamey for supper tonight." "Wouldn't you like to sing for your supper, like little Tommy Tucker?" said Armstrong. "Excellent idea. As you know, I've got a select and extensive repertoire, and, hello. Here's my little dog Bingo." A retriever came trotting out of the wood, stopped in the middle of the clearing and gazed for a moment inquiringly at the tent, just erected, then turned tail and trotted back. "A very gentlemanly dog," said Pratt. "No loud discordant bark, no inquisitive snuffling, evidence of good breeding and a kind master." "Hi there," called a loud voice. "What are you doing on my land? Who the deuce gave you permission to camp?" A stout, florid, white-whiskered gentleman of some 60 years, wearing a loose shooting costume and carrying a shotgun under his arm, hurried across the clearing, the retriever at his heels. "I'm sorry, sir," said Warrender politely. "We've come up the river, and this is the first suitable place we've found. If we had known..." Known, interrupted the stranger. You knew it wasn't common land public property. If you didn't know, anyone about here would have told you. Just so, sir. But we understood that a party had camped here a short while ago, and... You understood, boy. And where did you get your information? From a gamekeeper sort of man, a little below on the other bank. He. That'll do, snapped the sportsman. Take down that tent. Clear up all this disgusting litter, and be off. The place reeks with paraffin. Look alive now. Clear up all this disgusting litter. In silence, Warrender and Armstrong began to loosen the tent guys, while Pratt put out the stove and started to carry the properties down to the boat. He alone of the three showed no sign of feeling. His friends sometimes said that he was perennially happy because he was fat, not, as he himself explained, because he had music in his soul. Warrender's mouth had hardened, his face grown pale, sure indications of wrath. Armstrong, on the contrary, had flushed over the cheekbones and expended his anger in muscular energy, heaving unaided the tent to his back and carrying it, the pole, guys, and pegs, with the ease of a coal porter. The landowner stood sternly on guard until the place was cleared. The boat moved off. "Dashed old curmudgeon," growled Armstrong. "He and my Uncle Ambrose would make a pretty pair," remarked Pratt. "I'd give anything to hear a slanging match between 'em. Anything but this," he added, taking up his banjo. "I had a little dog, and his name was Bingo. His master's name ought to be Stingo. Eh, what?" "It happens to be Crawshay," said Warrender, pointing to a tree. Upon it was nailed a board, facing upstream, and bearing the half-obliterated legend, "Trespassers will be prosecuted." Below this, however, in fresh paint, were the words, "Camping prohibited, D-C-R-A-W-S-H-A-Y. "Precisely, D. Crawshay," said Armstrong. Chapter 2, Below the Belt. Something less than a mile up the river, they came upon an old-fashioned, gabled cottage of red brick, standing back a few yards from the left bank. The walls were half-covered with Virginia creeper. A purple clematis climbed over the porch and round a signboard bearing the words, "Ferry Inn." Beyond it, on rising ground some little distance away, glowed the red-tiled roofs of a straggling village. A ferry boat, or rather punt, lay alongside of a narrow landing stage. The lads tied the boat to a post and stepped onto the planking. At the closed door of the inn, standing with legs wide apart, was a little round man whose jolly, rubicund, clean-shaven face and twinkling eyes bespoke good humor and a contented soul. He was bareheaded in shirt sleeves and wore an apron. His brown straight hair was obviously a wig. In front of him stood a group of villagers. "'Tis past opening time, I tell ye," one of them was saying. "I can tell by the feel of my thropple." "'Twould be always opening time if you trusted to that, Mick," said the landlord with a laugh. "I go by my watch." He pulled out with some difficulty, from the tight band of his apron, a large silver timepiece. "There you are, 3 minutes to the hour." "Well, I reckon you be 3 minutes slow, and so you could swear to if so be." A slight jerk of the landlord's head caused the rustic to look along the road to the right. Strolling towards the inn was the village policeman. "He's had me fined once and I didn't deserve it," the landlord remarked. "And there's another who'd like to catch me tripping." His eyes traveled beyond the policeman and rested on a thin, loose-jointed man with a stubbly fair mustache and a close-cut beard who was hurrying to catch up with the constable. "Aye, Sammy Blevins do have a nature for such," said another of the rustics. "'Tis my belief he'll be caught tripping himself one o' these days." "Aye, and Constable Hairdstone too," said the first. "Birds of a feather. They be thick as thieves, they two, and no friends o' yours, Joe. Well, I bain't the man to glory in a friend's tribulation, and so you may keep your door shut till 3 minutes past. Say, when is this blame door opening?" The loud, hoarse voice caused a general turning of heads. From round the corner of the inn sauntered, somewhat unsteadily, his hands in his pockets, a big burly fellow whose red waistcoat, tight leather breeches, and long gaiters proclaimed some connection with horseflesh. His accent was nasal, but there was an undefinable something in his pronunciation that suggested a European rather than an American origin. A long fair mustache drooped round the corners of a wide straight mouth. His clean-shaven cheeks were thin and hard, his pale blue eyes heavy-lidded and watery. The rustics appeared to fall back a little as he approached. He leant one shoulder against a post of the porch and scowled at the landlord, attitude and gesture indicating that so far from needing refreshment, he had anticipated the opening of the door. "All in good time, Mr. Jensen," said the landlord placably. "Law's law, you know." "Law," scoffed the man. "I'm sober. I want a lemon squash. See, if you don't open that door, ah. I guess you know me." The landlord, consulting his watch, had turned, and now threw open the door leading into the bar. The foreigner entered behind him, and was followed by the villagers one by one. A pleasant-faced, motherly woman came out into the porch, and looked inquiringly at the three lads. They walked up from the landing stage, where they had lingered watching the scene. "Can we have some tea?" asked Warrender. "I sure," replied the woman. "They told me as three young gemmen had come up along in boat, and I says to myself 'tis tea as like as not. Sit ee down at thicky table, and I'll bring it out to ee." "We're pretty hungry," said Armstrong. "What can you give us?" "Why there 'tis, I've nothing but eggs and bacon."
"Glorious," said Pratt. "Two eggs apiece and bacon to match."
I know what young gemmen's appetite be," said Mrs. Rogers, smiling as she bustled away. They sat down at a table placed outside the window. Within they saw Rogers, the landlord, energetically pulling ale for his customers. He had laid aside his snuff-colored wig, revealing a scalp perfectly bald. While they were awaiting their meal, a girl, dressed in white, riding a bicycle, came along the road on the far side of the river, and dismounting at the landing stage, rang her bell continuously as a summons to the ferryman. An old weather-beaten man emerged from the back premises of the inn, touched his hat, hobbled down to his boat, and slowly pulled it across. The girl wheeled her bicycle onto it, chatted to the old man while he recrossed the river, paid him with a silver coin and smiling thanks, and having remounted, sped on towards the village.
"Why didn't I bring up my banjo?" said Pratt dolefully.
"Of course, I can sing without accompaniment. There's no sunbeam as bright as your smile. There's no gold like the sheen of your hair. But you do want the one-two-tum to get the full effect, don't you, eh?"
"You sentimental owl," exclaimed Armstrong, laughing. "Here comes our tea."
They had finished their meal, and were leaning back comfortably in their chairs, when the drone of talk within the inn was suddenly broken by voices raised in altercation. The clamor subsided for a moment under the landlord's protest, but burst forth again. There was a noise of scuffling, then two men appeared in the doorway, struggling together in the first aimless clinches of a fight. They stumbled over the step, behind them came the villagers in a group, some of them making half-hearted attempts by word and act to separate the combatants. These, reaching the open, shook off restraint, swung their arms as if to clear a space, and after a preliminary feint or two, rushed upon each other. Warrender and his friends got up. Were there ever schoolboys, even sixth formers and prefects, who were not interested in a fight? The antagonists were not unequally matched. Height and weight were on the side of the foreigner, but his opponent, apparently a young farmer, though slighter in build, had clear eyes and a healthy skin, contrasting with the other's well-marked signs of habitual excess. The rustics formed up on one side, looking on stolidly. The three lads moved round until they faced the inn door. On the step stood the landlord with arms akimbo. His wife came behind him, slapped his wig onto his head, and retreated. For a minute or two the combatants, displaying more energy than science, employed their arms like erratic piston rods, hitting the air more often than each other's body. Armstrong's lip curled with amusement as he watched them. Then they appeared to realize that they had started too precipitately, and drew apart to throw off their coats and recover their wind.
"What's the quarrel?" asked Warrender in the brief interval of the nearest bystander.
"Furriner chap," he said, "as the Germans be better fighters than us Englishmen," and that riled Henry drew,
he having the military medal and all. You can see the ribbon on his coat. Stripped to their shirts, the combatants faced each other. They sparred warily for a moment, then the farmer darted forward on his toes, landed a blow on the foreigner's nose between the eyes, and springing back out of reach, just escaped his opponent's counter. "One for his jib," murmured Armstrong. The blow and the subdued applause of the rustic onlookers enraged the foreigner. Swinging his bulk forward, he bore down on the slighter Englishman, appeared to envelop him, and for a few seconds the two men seemed to be a tangle of whirling arms. Suddenly Armstrong sprang towards them, shouting, "Foul blow!" At the same moment the farmer reeled, and the foreigner, following up his advantage, dealt him a furious body blow that dropped him flat as a turbot. Angry cries broke from the crowd, but before the slower-witted rustics could act, Armstrong dashed between Jensen and the prostrate man. "You hound," he cried. "You'll deal with me now." One arm was already out of its sleeve, but before he could fling off his blazer, the foreigner charged upon him like an infuriated bull. Armstrong sidestepped, threw his blazer on the ground, and stood firmly, ready to meet the next onrush. The foreigner charged upon him like an infuriated bull. The big man topped him by a couple of inches, and bore down as if to smother him by sheer weight. He shot out a long arm, Armstrong ducked, and quick as lightning got in a counter hit that took the foreigner by surprise and caused him to draw back an inch or two. Armstrong said afterwards that he ought to be shot for mistiming the blow, which he had expected to crack the man's windbox. Already breathing fast, the foreigner perceived that his only chance of winning was to strike at once. He lowered his head and swung out his left arm in a lusty drive at Armstrong's ribs. It was an opening not to be missed by a skilled boxer. With left foot well forward and body thrown slightly back, Armstrong dealt him a smashing right uppercut on the point of the chin. The man collapsed like a ninepin and measured his 6'2" on the ground. "Jolly good biff, old man," cried Pratt. "Won't somebody cheer?" The rustics were smiling broadly, but their satisfaction at the close of the battle found no more adequate mode of expression than a prolonged sigh and a cry, "Sarve and right." The farmer, however, a little pale about the gills, had risen to his feet, and approaching Armstrong said, "Thank ye, sir. 'Twas a rare good smite as ever I see, and I take it kind as a young gentleman should have." "Oh, that's all right," Armstrong interrupted, slipping on his blazer. "He should have fought fair." "True. A smite in the stomach don't give a man a chance. I feel queerish like, and I'll get Joe Rogers to give me a thimbleful and then shail home along. That's my Barton on the hill yonder, and if so be you're stopping hereabout, I'll be main glad to supply you and your friends with milk and cream." Assisted by two of his cronies, the farmer walked into the inn, the rest of the crowd hanging about and casting sheepish glances of admiration at Armstrong. "You'll come in and take a drop of summit, sir?" inquired the landlord. "No thanks," replied Armstrong. "You might have a look at that fellow, will you?" "And can you give us beds tonight?" asked Warrender. "I sure the missus will see to that." "Very well, we'll just go on to the village and get a thing or two, and come back before closing time. You'll give an eye to our boat?" The innkeeper having promised to set the ferryman in charge of the boat, the three struck into the road. Chapter 3, Prattle. The one street of the village contained only two shops. One of these, the forepart of a simple cottage, was post office and general store, whose window displayed groceries, sweetstuffs, stockings, reels of cotton, and other articles of a miscellaneous stock. A few yards beyond it stood a larger, newer, and uglier building, the lower story of which was a double-fronted shop, exhibiting on the one side a heterogeneous heap of old iron, on the other a few agricultural implements, a ramshackle bicycle, a mangle, tin teapots, a can of petrol, a concertina, and various oddments. Above the door, in crude letters painted yellow, ran the description: "Samuel Blevins, General Dealer." "We must try the post office," said Warrender. "But I don't expect we'll find anything up to much. Still, there'll be some local views." They entered the little shop, filling the space in front of the counter, and began to examine picture postcards. The shopkeeper, a middle-aged woman in a widow's cap, was in the act of handing packets of baking powder to a customer, a small man who turned quickly about as the boys went in, showing a plump brown face decorated with a tiny black mustache and dark vivacious eyes. "And how be your missus?" the woman was saying. "She is vir vel," said the man, swinging round again. "Zat is not bad, not bad. She have a cold, yes, shoost a leetle cold." "I be man glad 'tis nothing worse," said the shopkeeper dryly. Rogers did say only this morning, as he hadn't seed or heard anything of her for a week or more, and her his own sister too, and not that breadth between 'em. She might as well be in foreign parts. 'Twas never thoughted when she married you, Mr. Rod. My meaning is, Rogers believed her'd always be in and out being so near, whereas the truth is he sees no more of her than if she lived at t'other end of the kingdom. "And now ze Isinglass," said the man, with the obvious intention of turning the conversation. "Vat? No Isinglass? Zees is terrible country. Vel, zet is all, madam. You put everying in ze book. Trust me for that, Mr. Rod. Remember me to Mary, and I hope she'll soon be rid of her cold." The man gathered up his purchases and left the shop, darting a glance at each of the boys as he passed them. They bought a few postcards and some postage stamps and issued forth into the street. Blevins, the general dealer, standing at his shop door with his hands under his coat tails, gave them a hard look. "These country folk are as inquisitive as moths," remarked Armstrong. "Take us for strolling minstrels, I dare say," rejoined Pratt. "Lucky I didn't bring my banjo." "Our blazers make us a trifle conspicuous," said Warrender. "I say, as we've plenty of time before dark, and I don't want to run into that crowd at the inn again, suppose we stroll on." They passed the general dealers, soon left the last of the cottages behind them, and rambled along the grassy bank of the road, which wound across a wide and barren heathland. About half a mile from the village, they came to narrower cross roads, leading apparently to the few scattered farmsteads of the neighborhood. A few yards beyond this they saw, rounding a bend, a girl on a bicycle coasting down a slight hill towards them. "The fair maiden white," said Pratt. "I think my banjo ought to have been a guitar, or a lute, whatever that is." A loud report startled them all. The bicycle wobbled, stopped, and the girl sprang lightly from her saddle and bent down to examine the front tire. She rose just before the boys reached her, gave them a fleeting glance, and started to wheel the machine down the road. After a brief hesitation, Warrender turned towards her, lifting his cap. "Can I be of any assistance?" he asked. "Oh, please don't trouble," replied the girl. "It's a frightfully bad puncture, and I haven't very far to go. Some distance across the ferry." "Well, yes, but this will take a long time and I really couldn't think of—" "It's no trouble if you have an outfit."
"Yes, I have, but—"
"He's a dab at mending tires, I assure you," Pratt broke in. "Also at all sorts of tinkering old jobs. Our engine broke down the other day. That's our motor boat, down at the ferry, you know. I dare say you saw it when you passed an hour ago, or was it 2? It seems a jolly long time. Do let him try his hand, he'll be heartbroken if you don't. Besides, wheeling a bicycle is no joke, I know from experience, and for a lady, why, there's a smudge on your dress already."
"Really?"
Like many loquacious persons, Pratt was apt to let his tongue run away with him. The girl had shown more and more amusement with every sentence that bubbled from his glib lips, and here she broke into a frank laugh and surrendered the bicycle to Warrender, who laid it down on the grass bordering the road, opened the tool pouch, and set to work. "He may be nervous and fumble a bit, you know," said Pratt, "if we look at him. I used to be like that myself when I was young. Don't you think we'd better walk on? Perhaps you'd like to be shown over our boat."
"I think I'd prefer to wait for my bicycle," said the girl demurely.
"Gorinder's quite to be trusted," rejoined Pratt. "He isn't just an ordinary tramp or tinker. We've none of us chosen our professions yet. We have been called the Three Musketeers in some quarters."
"At school, I suppose," the girl put in. Because we're always together, you know, Pratt continued. We came up the river today on a holiday cruise, all the joys of nautical adventure, without any of the discomforts.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.